Welcome back. This session is going to be on how gravitational waves can be used to probe dense matter. We have three presentations by three experts. One of them is from gravitational waves. Other one is from the area of nuclear physics. And the third one from electromagnetic probes of neutron stars. And that's because we are quite hopeful that those latter observations will complement gravitational wave observations to teach us more about these dense, compact objects. And of course, we are doing all of this partly in celebration of Bala's 65th. Everybody knows here that he is one of the leading experts in post-Newtonian theory. But the fact is that he has also contributed to the topic of this session. He has written papers on ultra-compact objects, as well as on core envelope separations in collapse scenarios. There are more papers, by the way, so if you're interested, you should Google them. So on that note, let us get started. Our first speaker is Dr. Wolfgang Gatzaun from Max Planck Institute for Gravitational Physics in Hanover. And he is the gravitational wave expert that I talked about.
Okay, so it's a pleasure to be here, and I thank for the invitation. First of all, I was asked to give an overview talk, and then I did a quick archive search, and I saw I don't have an overview. There are at least 1,000 relevant papers, so this will be a rather subjective selection of topics. But let's get started. Quick outline, so I will first speak a bit about what constraints can we get from the in-spiral gravitational wave signal alone, without any electromagnetic information. Then I will mention what can we learn if we know the type of the outcome without saying yet how we know that. And if there's time, I will briefly talk a bit about connections to kilonova and short gamma ray burst. But this is more a topic for the multi-messenger talk, so I will be brief. And then I will also talk about few other avenues that did not lead to any constraints with that detection. So here we go with the first part, quick introduction in the parameter space. So you probably all know that we have the Chirp mass, which is just a combination of the two neutron star masses. This is measured almost exactly. So for all intents and purposes, think of that as known exactly. Then we have the mass ratio, which is not constrained that well. And we have the effective spin parameter, which is basically a mass-weighted combination of the aligned spin components. And mass ratio and spin are sort of degenerate. So that is why almost all results presented are basically giving two answers. One, if you assume that the initial stars are not rapidly rotating, and the other set of results without that assumption. Finally, we have a spin precession parameter, which for the binary neutron star detected event didn't seem to play much of a role. At least there was no indication for precession. So I'm not going to mention this much. The most important parameter is, of course, the tidal deformability. You all know that. It measures how the quadrupole moment of a neutron star changes in a tidal field. And this depends strongly on the EOS, which is why a good candidate to constrain the equation of state of a neutron star. And for a given equation of state, it's mainly a function of the mass. Although there might be complications, like if you have really rapid rotation, things might be dynamical instead of static, so this might add complications. We don't really have considered superfluidity yet. There are also some investigations if the timescale in the final phase of the merger is enough to actually allow nuclear equilibrium to breach again. So there are a lot of things related to that, but I will not talk about this. The relevant parameter for the in-spiral is the effective tidal deformability, which is just a linear combination of the two neutron star tidal deformabilities. And annoyingly, this linear combination depends on the mass ratio. So if the mass ratio is not well constrained, this complicates tying what we measure to what we want to know about the equation of state. Another important thing is that if the effective tidal deformability is given, the actual difference between the tidal deformabilities does not play a significant role, at least at the current sensitivities. So practically, we cannot measure the individual tidal deformabilities, only the effective one. So here's a quick diagram. You can probably criticize this a lot. This is just tentative, what's harder to measure. So the most drastic impact is by the job mass. So this is measured best. Then mass ratio and spin come next. And as I said, they are sort of degenerate. Then we might have precession effects, but in this detected event, there was no indication. And also the waveform models are currently developed to account for precession fully. So I'm not talking about precession. Then the effective tidal deformability, it's a much smaller effect, but it also affects the waveform differently than the job mass, for example. So you can still sort of disentangle it, although there is still a residual degeneracy with the mass ratio. And then we have quantities that are basically not measurable currently. There is a spin-induced quadrupole that was mentioned earlier, and the differences of deformabilities, they are also not something you can constrain currently. One thing I like to really stress is that the neutron star radii do not enter the waveform. So it's not something you can measure directly. You can only infer it. So there's a question.
I interrupt now? Or?
Yeah.
Well, that's not completely true, no? Because larger radio will make the spiral stop earlier.
Okay, so if it's two white dwarfs, that we would see. But if it's just 10 versus 12 kilometers, the frequency will still be in a region where we don't really have a good signal to noise. So it doesn't contribute much. I agree, there might be some with better detectors. There might be a point where we can actually see this directly. But I'm now talking about the detected event. So.
But can I understand better what do you mean that we don't measure it directly? Is it so important? There are many parameters that, you know, there are parameters that depend on parameters. So why is it so important to say that it doesn't, it does affect the spiral waveform through other parameters? So,
right, so the point I will be making is that you always need to make some model assumption to infer the radius from the tidal deformability. So I will come back to this later. So maybe we move that to the discussion session. So here, I think we all agree that the radius is not a parameter that is directly appearing in the waveform. So that's the point I'm trying to make here. It's a tidal deformability. So let's get to the results. So this is what is actually measurable. There are some trivial things. So first of all, we have the masses that are detected. Here are the results if you assume slow rotation or don't, and you see that the job mass is very well confined. That's why this two-dimensional region is basically just a curve. And we also know that the heavier object is at least around 1.36 m solar. So the maximum neutron star mass must be above that. It's not very useful yet because we know pulsars that are heavier. Another thing is the spin. So here is spin versus mass ratio. The, you see again this degeneracy I mentioned, and also the spin is compatible with zero. So there's no constraint here to be made. Although it would be anyway surprising if neutron stars rotate rapidly enough to make any constraints on the equation of state. So no one expected that. So let's come to the more interesting part, the tidal deformability. So before I talk about what was detected, let's talk about what could be detected with an ideal detection, without noise. So basically, you would get a data point in job mass, effective tidal deformability, and mass ratio. And if you know the equation of state, you can compute the tidal deformability, the effective tidal deformability as a function of job mass and mass ratio. So that's what's plotted here for a bunch of nuclear physics equations of state. You have the effective tidal deformability on the y-axis and 1 over the mass ratio on the x-axis. And at some point, of course, you reach the maximum mass of the heavier, with a heavier object, and then this curve ends. Okay, a couple of things. First of all, there's a large range in tidal deformability depending on the equation of state. The other, that some of these curves cross. So let's say you have an ideal measurement at this point, then you cannot distinguish this green curve from this black curve. And this is basically, it means you could not distinguish these two equations of state, even with an ideal measurement. Another thing is an interesting question about the maximum mass. So can we constrain directly the maximum neutron star mass? And the answer is no. For example, let's say you have an ideal measurement at this point. You see there are several equations of state passing through, this green one and the black one. And you see that the maximum masses are quite different. So even though they lead to the same effective tidal deformability at a certain mass ratio, it's a totally different maximum mass. Oh, the green ones are just the ones that are not explicitly labeled here. So it's basically just a bunch of models, not individually distinguished. The only meaningful thing is purple. That means equation of states that become acausal before reaching the maximum mass. And you see one of the most extreme ones is actually becoming acausal. So they are to be treated with care. Another thing I like to point out is if you have a mixed binary, you can get the same effective tidal deformability if you just have a different equation of state. So in principle, it's if the masses are supported by the equation of state, you cannot distinguish between a mixed binary and a binary black hole. Okay, here's the same plot with an actual measurement. So this is a posterior and mass ratio and effective tidal deformability. Again, with two cases, assuming high spin and low spin, and you see the mass ratio is much more constrained if you don't assume, if you assume low spin. This study was making very few assumptions. So first of all, the objects are arbitrary. It could be black holes, neutron star, quark stars, whatever. There's no assumption on the tidal deformability. In particular, it's not assumed that it depends on the mass, and it's not assumed that it depends on the mass in the same way for the two objects. And this was also using a uniform prior in lambda 1, lambda 2, the two tidal deformabilities. And a different way to plot that is if you marginalize over the mass ratio and plot the individual deformabilities, of course, there's a high degree of degeneracy. But comparing the two curves you expect for the US, you can still see that some of them are becoming pretty unlikely. For example, the MS1 seems to be certainly ruled out now. So another thing I'd like to point out is that since we have a uniform prior in this rectangular region, low tidal deformability is actually very unlikely from the prior. So the prior already disfavors that, which was one of the reasons that in the same study, results have also been presented with a modified prior, where you basically divide by the marginalized effective tidal deformability prior to make it flat. And I mean, this is an ad hoc modification. It's debatable. One should still discuss a prior impact, as I will mention. But it still does not correspond to a common equation of state assumption. That said, here are the results. So you see the effective tidal deformability posterior, and this is done for different waveform models to get a handle on the systematic. And you can see that there is some impact, but at least you get a relatively independent upper limit somewhere between 700 and 800 something. So higher values are ruled out pretty certain. I will also talk a little bit about lower limits later. For now, I just want to point out that for the low spin assumption, lower limits were presented, so in the sense of credible intervals. Another study was using universal relations. So the motivation is that now you want to assume that both new objects are neutron stars and both have the same equation of state, but you do not want to assume a specific equation of state. So what you do is to use phenomenological relations to first of all compute the individual deformabilities from the effective one. And second, since they also wanted to compare to or give constraints in the radius, to compute the radii from the deformability. That was also related to the earlier comment why I think it's an inference. So there is still a certain model dependence here. These universal relations are not really completely US independent. There is a certain residual, and they have been calibrated with around 12 models, or how the paper put it, a large set of models. And there are actually two papers doing that, one from the LVC and one from Shumide et al. They only differ in the exact relations they use. I will talk about the collaboration paper. So what you do is you reparametrize basically the individual deformabilities by the average deformability and the difference. And then you express the difference as a function of the average and the mass ratio. This is a complicated expression here. I don't go into the details. Just want to mention that the coefficients are calibrated using a few equation of state models. And one thing I also like to point out is that these universal relations are also used in a range that is explicitly forbidden by the models used to calibrate them. So that is a point, a subtle point often overlooked. So it's not fully consistent. These models used for calibration do not contain any quark stars or strong phase transitions. So that was another point of criticism. And phase transitions might actually change the tidal deformability. And the point is important because you might be able to reach lower deformabilities at the measured mass range if you include more models. That said, here are results. It is posterior in the mass radius space in blue and red for the two neutron stars, and overplotted are various equation of state curves. I stress again that this is inferred. So what's measured is the tidal deformability and the masses. And then the universal relations are used to get the radii. So there is a certain model dependence. That is just something to keep in mind. Another method was operating differently. So there's the idea is to just parameterize the equation of state and then do Bayesian parameter estimation on these equation of state parameters. So the LBC study was using something called spectral representation. It's causal by construction. And you can then get constraints on these equation of state parameters and then draw also constraints in the actual pressure versus density plane that characterizes an equation of state. When interpreting this plot, one has to take some care, of course, because, for example, the density in the inspiring neutron stars is confined to roughly this region here. So anything above that, there is no information in the gravitational wave signal about these densities. So this is an extrapolation. Making also use of the fact that we have a constraint on the maximum neutron star mass from pulsar observations. Some other thing you could criticize is that this EOS parameter space is multidimensional, but the thing you actually measure related to the EOS is just one quantity, the tidal, the effective tidal deformability. So there should be a degenerate subspace that is not constrained by measurement at all. And of course, in this subspace, there is also a certain assumption on the prior probability density. And this hasn't been discussed in any detail yet. So that is something to improve in the future. And in general, the role of the prior could be investigated a bit more, in my opinion. So there is still stuff to do. So an important question is if there is actually proof for tidal effects. So is there a reliable lower limit by observation? And some studies presented lower credible bounds. But of course, this is based on Bayesian statistics. So the posterior is a combination of the prior assumptions you put in and the measurement data. And you should always look at the impact of the prior. And in particular for low limits, this is important because low tidal deformability also have a lower impact on the signal. So you would expect that below a certain point, it's all prior dominated. And this is something I looked at recently, and in an upcoming paper, I will show, give some arguments that these lower limits might be completely dominated by the prior and a few other assumptions. For example, for the universal relation study, some regions were excluded by construction. But I'm not going to details here. This is just a word of caution. So another thing is about the waveform systematics. So for lower limits, if they are really if they are really dominated by the prior, then the actual waveform is irrelevant. So you will get a very good agreement. It will basically only depend on the upper limits you get. And then your error estimates you get by just doing the statistical analysis with different waveform models might actually underestimate this error. So we did also another cross-check just comparing waveforms. And unless you trust one particular waveform model much more than the differences between all the current models you have, I think limits below around 200 for the effective tidal deformability for this event a bit questionable, so one needs to reinvestigate the waveform systematics for that. That is my opinion, so it's not published yet. I just want to put this out here for discussion. That brings me to another study that is a very recent one. It's not based on credible intervals, but now we are doing model selection. So I remind you that credible intervals do not actually tell you anything about the likelihood of models. So if you do a two-sided credible interval on something that just falls off continuously, a model out below the lower limit will actually be more likely than a model above or above the lower limit. So you always have to look at the shape of the prior, and only for Gaussians you can really have direct quantitative connection to the likelihood of a model. So what was done now is just compare base factors between specific equation of state models. So that basically gives you relative probabilities that the noisy data contains a signal based on these two models. So this is the study. It's pretty new, just on the archive. We performed a model comparison between 24 different nuclear physics equation of state. One of them is also a quark hadron model. So that's a new thing. We did this each for 5 different waveform models. And of course, we consider again the high and low spin priors. And I just show the main result here. I should explain this plot. So the x-axis is the natural logarithm of the base ratio of each equation of state model with respect to some fiducial fixed equation of state model. The y-axis in the lower row is the radius of a 1.36 solar mass neutron star with that equation of state. And on the upper row, it's the tidal deformability of such a star. The left column corresponds to the narrow spin prior, so low spins, and the right to the unconstrained spin prior. And one thing you can see that there's a clear trend that larger radii and tidal deformability are increasingly disfavored compared to lower values. I also added some upper credible bounds from previous studies, and you see that even above those, there are a few models which are not really strongly disfavored. So that was this difference between credible intervals and likelihood of particular models I was talking about earlier. But at least two of these equations of state, the MS1 and MS1b, are strongly ruled out for all waveform models. We also looked if we can rule out the binary black hole case with base factors, and for this detected event, we couldn't. So there is still no proof that this was not a binary black hole based on gravitational wave alone. Another thing we looked at is what happens after merger if you assume a certain equation of state. So we looked at basically the masses compared to the maximum neutron star masses for the given equation of state model and made some inferences about the type of remnant, hypermassive, supermassive, short-lived, long-lived. And we could basically only disfavor infinitely stable remnants, but otherwise all outcomes are still possible from prompt collapse to very long-lived objects. Also, prompt collapse could be ruled out for a few specific equation of state. Now, let me switch topic again. What if we know the remnant type? What can we say then from the gravitational wave data? So the idea is that the gravitational wave in spiral provides an upper limit on the total mass. And we know that the remnant lifetime depends critically on the mass. So there's a certain mass window where the lifetime increases drastically, and this window depends strongly on the equation of state. So if you assume that you are somewhere in this window, you can get information about the equation of state. And depending what assumptions you make, you get tighter or looser constraints. So if you just exclude that the black hole was formed at all, you only get loose constraints. This was first done in this GWGRB paper here. We also did this in the model selection, and the strongest bound we got, if we assume, is that the remnant is in the hypermassive mass range for the true equation of state, was around 2.3 solar masses. There were also some earlier studies getting basically similar results based on the measured gravitational wave range that was published earlier. And that was for the narrow spin. So if you allow for rapid rotation, the constraints are not as strong. So there was also another study recently that didn't make direct assumptions where you are in this mass range, but also looked at numerical relativity trends and looked at angular momentum balance. In general, it was a very complex analysis, and that also arrived at a similar limit. Okay, I don't have much time, so I will hurry through that. I will not exactly explain mass ejection in kilonova, only that there are different types of ejecta. Dynamical and disk winds. And you can, from the kilonova, infer basically mass, velocity, and composition of these components. And since we have a lot of spectral information, there can be a lot of inference depending how good your kilonova models are. So There are some complications, so you need to consider interactions via radiation transport between different components. That was a recent article. There also might be energy input from a long-lived remnant. So this is not a finished thing. This is an ongoing modeling effort. Now, how do we use that? If we have numerical, we have a lot of numerical simulations looking at dynamical ejecta, and typically they produce less ejecta than were inferred for this kilonova event. So we need also contributions from the disk that is forming after merger. Of course, it's difficult to model the expelled fraction, but if you assume that all of the disk is expelled, you get an upper limit. And, I skip this. And this was done in this study here, basically postulating a correlation between the effective tidal deformability and the total ejecta mass you can get if also the disk is ejected. And you see that looks like, there is some line where this crosses what we need, and then we get a limit for the tidal deformability. But other studies have shown that there are not enough models considered here, in particular regarding the mass ratio. So this correlation isn't actually a correlation. This is just based on too few models. So this is essentially destroyed. I wouldn't believe this limit. Another thing is short gamma ray bursts. The important questions are here for our purposes, does the short gamma ray require a black hole? Because then again, we can constrain the remnant outcome. I have mentioned that before, what we can do with that. And also, it would be interesting to know if an SGRB is compatible with prompt collapse, because for prompt collapse, you typically also have almost no disk, and most models need a disk. There are two scenarios, black hole embedded in a magnetized disk or a magneti embedded in a disk. And they could either both be valid or only one of them. We don't know yet. Numerical simulations can just give us a few hints. So there are some promising precursors for the black hole case, but nothing really conclusive. The best was by Ruiz, which actually found a mildly relativistic outflow. So that might form a real jet at some point. A recent simulation I was involved in looked at the magnetar scenario, and the results were somewhat discouraging. First of all, the magnetic field structure didn't really look very ordered. And more important, the density of matter along the rotation axis remained way too high to allow for a jet. So this is probably the most important obstacle for this magnetar scenario. Okay, let me briefly summarize some other avenues. One is, of course, a post-merger signal search. In short, nothing was expected to be found and nothing was found. So here's, for example, what you expect for the direct post-merger oscillation excited during merger from numerical relativity. And this is the upper limits that were obtained for this type of signal. And there's a factor of 10 between those two. So to be really constraining, you would have a 10 times better, let's say a source which is 10 times closer. They also looked for other remnant oscillations. There was also a paper looking for long time oscillations recently, and nothing was found. So, but nothing was really expected to be found. Another thing is so-called PG effects. So during in spiral, in principle, the tidal force can excite neutron star oscillation. And there's not enough time for a resonant excitation, but you can have something called non-resonant, non-linear instability, which involves a coupling of different mode types, in, for example, pressure modes and G modes. And in effect, the orbital energy would be dissipated into these modes. And this might affect the in-spiral waveform. And this was looked for with two different studies. An important parameter is the saturation amplitude of these instabilities, which is not very well constrained by theory. So it was a free parameter here. The first study found neither evidence for nor against this model. The other study claimed strong evidence against PG mode instabilities, but later there was some discussion, and apparently this is based on an error in the way the base factors were computed. However, there are still no constraints from this on the equation of state. And yeah, with that, I'm using up my time, I think. Thank you.
Thank you, Wilson. Questions? Patrick?
This is concerning the determination of equation of state from the tidal deformation. Now, was the magnetic stress and the rotation stress that also affects the deformation, apart from the tidal forces, taken into account into the analysis?
So as far as I know, no one assumes that the magnetic energy density is high enough to affect this. Maybe I'm wrong, but I mean, there are some numerical relativity simulations with really strong initial fields doing in spiral, and you don't see any deviation. Also, they are not accurate enough to see small effects, so that is maybe not a good indication. But in general, if you compare the energy density in a magnetic field to the binding energy, even with 10 to the 15 Gauss, this is pretty small. So the normal tidal deformability is probably dominating that, although I cannot give you a precise number.
But there will be also effects of the angular momentum, the centrifugal force stress, would also contribute to the deformation. And when it is, when the two neutron stars are nearby, there'll be precession and these effects.
Yeah, so what you mean is this spin-induced quadrupole. So if the star is rotating rapidly, it is deformed oblate. And this is in the waveform models in a rather phenomenological way. It is tied to the tidal deformability. So there is some, this is considered in a way, but it's also argued that this is a relatively small effect. But I'm not an expert on that, so maybe I can forward this question.
No, actually, this quadrupole is included in the waveforms. It is included in the waveforms.
Yeah, as
the
far
waveforms
as I know,
are not
is,
the one for the binary.
There's a parameter that is tied to the tidal deformability.
It's not tied to the. It's tied to the compactness of the.
Okay. In a
I don't think it depends on the tidal deformability. It depends on the compactness. It's just the quadrupole, which is not the one from for black holes, but.
So.
It's another term in the post-Newtonian expansion, which is different between.
Yeah, which is tracked separately
stars.
From the effect of the tidal deformability parameter.
But they are correlated because they depend both on the compactness. And it is an important term, which is included in the waveforms.
Yes, I mean, you mentioned it in your earlier talks that with third generation, we might actually be able to disentangle these two things. But I think currently, at least in the collaboration paper, it was argued that it's a small effect and. Also degenerate with mass ratio and spin, right?
Any other questions for
Wolfgang? I just wanted to clarify. So this is a term that depends on this. It's proportional also to the spin. And so, of course, if the spin of the neutron star is small, then the effect is not very large. And because we are not finding, you know, the spin prior in the results you were showing is
yes,
0.
So.
Point,
yeah, here. So that it's very small. The spin 0.1 is not a very strong deformation for a neutron star.
Okay, we'll take one more question before we
just,
move to.
So this is regarding your comment. You said that. Hello. Yeah. So this is regarding your comment that you said there is no SGRB emerged in simulation. But is it just a matter of a spatial or time resolution? Or people have put all the physics there?
That's a complicated question. So first of all, magnetic field effects are always underresolved in numerical studies. There are small-scale amplification effects, so this is not really a well-converged result you get in simulations. Second, you need they are very expensive, so you cannot evolve for 2 seconds or whatever the SGRB delay was, 1.7. So the longest we have is 100 milliseconds after merger. And it could well be that if you wait long enough, the field will organize further and you see something. So I think it's currently really hard to say. All we have is hints from numerical simulation.
But the physics you think is there. Like we don't need any like that. The physics they think is there already?
I didn't understand. So you said plasma?
Yeah, electron positron plasma. This is one of the proposal by Ramesh and Pirat.
I mean, there are different physical effects that are also not taken into account, like resistive effects and so on. That's another good question, yeah. But I think the errors you already have without these effects are large enough, so we don't worry about them yet. So I repeat, I wouldn't trust numerical simulations to give you a concrete answer here. In the very near future. So it's more or less a guess. Like, for example, this baryon pollution is a good hint that you might then investigate analytically if you can have, or semi-analytically if you can have a jet poking through this. But to directly see a jet, it's a very complicated problem.